Everybody to Cornerstone Baptist Church this morning. It's great to be here on this Memorial Day weekend. Please all, let's all stand together if you're able, and feel free to sing along with the choir. We sing Star Spangled Banner. About you, but I'm glad to be a Christian. Amen.
Amen.
I'm glad to be an American as well. Amen. So we'll start the song number 573, God of Our Fathers.
God of our fathers, whose almighty hand leads forth in beauty all the starry
for the word of prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the land you give us, Lord, to play, serve, love you, Father. I pray that, Father, you go and guide and direct us today as the pastor preaches your precious word. We pray that, Lord, that we'll see souls saved, and we pray that we see hearts rededicated. And Lord, we pray that you'll be glorified in everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
next song we call our handshake song. So after that first chorus, please greet one another around you. Battle Hymn of the Republic, song number 569.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Turn around and shake hands. Please greet our visitors.
On the third verse, he has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him, be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Was born across the sea with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. While God is marching on,
sing it out.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Thank you very much. Please be seated, and the choir will sing.
Thank you.
Choir, appreciate that. Good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone Baptist Church. We're so happy to have you here this morning. And we have a couple announcements here. Church office and school office will be closed tomorrow in observance to Memorial Day. And also, any man that wants to enter the men's golf retreat, the Lighthouse Men's Golf Retreat, it's the weekend after Father's Day. So please see Brian Rubeck for more details. And if you look at our mortgage gauge, it came down quite a bit. We're sitting at, what is it, Pastor Hagley, 177. So thank you for everyone that's been given towards that. And so we are moving down closer to financial freedom, okay? So praise the Lord for that. Kids Summer Club and VBS workers, sign-up sheet is in the lobby. We have a lot of fun things planned this summer for the kids. And so our Kids Summer Club is going to be July 1st, July 8th, and July 15th. That's at 3 o'clock to 5:30, and it's going to be a great time. Activities, snacks, prizes. We're giving away prizes and just memorizing scripture and Bible lessons too. So it's going to be a great time, and we need some helpers with that. And so if you're interested, please sign up in the lobby. And then also VBS is coming up real quick, July 16th through the 19th, and the first day of the VBS is going to be Sunday morning. We're all going to be a part of it. We're going to have the Ranger Walker and his crew is going to be in here Sunday morning. And so, kids, get the word out. Invite your friends. There's going to be a lot of songs, and we're going to see a pony and a horse ride a pony, and it's going to be awesome. And so we're going to be a part of it. So, and make sure you wear Western wear, okay? If you want to wear your cowboy boots, your spurs, your vest, 10-gallon hat, whatever, okay? Just come and have a great time with it. And then after the Sunday morning service, July 16th, we're having a mini carnival. We're going to have hot dogs and bounce houses and stuff. And then the big carnival for the kids is going to be on Wednesday. Okay, so get the word out about it, and let's make plans to have a good time with that. And then right after the service tonight, we're going to have a church business meeting, and that's going to be discussing the missions budget this year and the possibility of adding two new missionaries. And so make sure you join us for that as we discuss the missions budget during the business meeting tonight. And then Allie's baby shower is coming up, and it's June 9th. And what time is that? June 9th at 5 p.m. And so please see my wife, ladies, if you're wanting more details about that. That's going to be in the fellowship hall. And Allie, where are you registered at? Amazon and Target, okay? So if you want to go online and check out her registry, you can do that. And it'll be a blessing to Allie and her family. Several people on our prayer list, Ken Davis, the missionary friend of Brother McNamara, Brother McNamara's dad, passed away. And so pray for the Davis family. And then pray for Brian Rubig's grandfather, John Caselli. And pray for Minnie Epperson. Frank, any update on any? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glad to hear that. Continue to pray for Miss Kay Turner. She's still dealing with that inner eye infection and still having trouble with that. So keep her in your prayers. Pray for Jim McCurry with pancreatic cancer. And then Mike Fetters, we got an update this morning with pancreatic cancer. It's spreading. And he's actually, the cancer is in his spine and he's paralyzed from the waist down. So please keep Mike in your prayers. And so many others on our prayer list. Pray for the Miss Puschik's, her brother-in-law passed away, so pray for Miss Puschik's family, and also continue to pray for Mrs. Thompson. It's good to see her here this morning, and also the family dealing with the loss of Miss Grethel, and so continue to pray for the family. And also pray for Margarita. She has a doctor's appointment at June 24th at 5 p.m. And we'll go ahead and pray for the offering at this time. And we're so happy to have you visitors with us today. And we don't expect you to give anything. We want some of these church members to give, though. And we'll pray that the Lord moves your heart to give right now. So Brian will come pray for the offering, and we'll continue with service.
It's all to be in your house this morning. Be with us this morning. Allow your Holy Spirit to work in our hearts. Be in the Spanish ministry and the kids' programs as well. Now, as we take up your offering, we ask, as we give a small portion back to you, you bless it, and we can see your work furthered here at Cornerstone, as well as supporting our missionaries around the world. Empower Pastor Morton this morning. Open up our hearts with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We have a special presentation for this special weekend, this Memorial Day, and just a reminder of what it's really all about. It's about honoring those who paid the ultimate sacrifice for the freedom that we enjoy on a daily basis. And as we look around our country, I think you'd probably agree that we all need to be reminded of that great sacrifice and that freedom is not free. So we'll share that video with you at this time.
Sometime back, I received in the name of our country the bodies of four Marines who had died while on active duty. I said then that there is a special sadness that accompanies the death of a serviceman, for we're never quite good enough to them. Not really, we can't be, because what they gave us is beyond our powers to repay. And so when a serviceman dies, it's a tear in the fabric, a break in the whole, and all we can do is remember. It is, in a way, an odd thing to honor those who died in defense of our country, in defense of us, in wars far away. The imagination plays a trick. We see these soldiers in our mind as old and wise. We see them as something like the founding fathers, grave and gray-haired. But most of them were boys when they died, and they gave up two lives, the one they were living and the one they would have lived. When they died, they gave up their chance to be husbands and fathers and grandfathers. They gave up their chance to be revered old men. They gave up everything for our country, for us. We owe them a debt we can never repay. All we can do is remember them and what they did and why they had to be brave for us.
Amen to that. Please stand with us. We'll sing song number 279, Faith of Our Fathers.
Faith of our fathers living still, in spite of dungeon fire and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whene'er we hear that glorious word. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Our fathers chained in prisons dark were still in heart and conscience free. How sweet would be their children's faith if they like them could die for thee. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death.
This time, junior church, please be dismissed to meet your leader in the back. On verse 3, all together now.
Faith of our fathers, we will strive to win all nations unto thee, and through the truth that comes from God, mankind shall then be truly free. Sing it out. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death.
On the final verse.
Faith of our fathers, we will love both friend and foe in all our strife, and preach thee too as love knows how, by kindly words and virtuous life. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death.
Thank you. You may be seated. Right before the message, the St. Vilas family will sing.
Salute the flag and say, I love this land. From sea to shining sea, I love this land. Home of the brave and free, I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth on which we stand. One nation under
all across the country, they sing.
this land, home of the brave and free. I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth on which we stand, one nation under God. I love this land,
from sea to shining sea.
I love this land, home of the brave and free. I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth on which we stand, one nation under
very much. And I just want to say amen to that song. I love America. I love this land. And I know she's hurting and she's not what she used to be, but I still love America. And I'm proud to be an American. And I'm proud to say that America was not founded for any other reason, but some people wanted to worship freely in a country where they could do that. And I love America. And I love those that have given their lives for it. And today is a testimony of the sacrifice that was given by so many. And so many people that are here in our congregation this morning were willing to make that sacrifice if that's what it took. And so I want to recognize those in our church congregation this morning that are either in currently or have served in our nation's military. Would you please stand? Would you please stand? We want to honor you folks this morning. Anybody else like that? Just give them a hand. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, all the brave men and women. There's certainly more. A lot of people are out of town this week, and I want to say thank you to everybody that has served in our country. And Brother Tarr was right. What we enjoy, freedom, was not free. It was a price that was paid by millions of young men, young women that have died on foreign fields, foreign soil, to keep the enemy away from coming on this soil. And I want to say thank you to everybody that's served in our country this morning. Today's a special day, has already been said. We remember those who have served and who still serve and have given their life's blood in the purchasing of our freedom that we have today. And the brave men and women, our military, they surrendered to freedom's call when it came calling for them. And they felt compelled to sacrifice their lives in service to our country. We celebrate the nation America that they fought for, they served for, and gave their life for. And our America today is not perfect. We have problems for sure, but I believe it's still the greatest country on the earth. And I believe it's still a nation that's worth serving, a nation that's still worth praying for, a nation that's still worth sacrificing for, and a nation worth fighting for. The forces of evil, our enemies, are trying their dead level best to come against us and to infringe upon those rights and liberties and freedoms. And I want to say thank you to all the men and women, my nephews, my brother-in-laws that used to serve. I have four brother-in-laws that are either were Marines and one's currently, right, one's still currently a Marine. And I have a nephew that just went to the Marines, and my nephew that just graduated is thinking about joining the Army. And so I don't wake up in America. I don't see the American flag and it means nothing. I know that there's people that have given their life so I can wake up and stand right here what I'm doing right now. I want to say thank you to all those people that do that. And I'm also aware that under our current leadership, our country has moved extremely left and extremely away from what caused us to be a great nation, and that's God and His Word. The president and his cronies have tried their best to remove any presence of being associated with being a Christian nation today. I'm well aware of that. They promote abortion, the gay pride, same-sex, transgender corruption. They call evil good and good evil. And by living a life that blasphemes the office that they were sworn in and blasphemes God himself. But I believe that God can use and still desires to use America like he used to in the past. And God has used our country to be a safe haven for pilgrims that have moved to America to worship the Lord freely. And America still represents that purpose today. There's still people that are moving all across this globe here. Why is that? Because they understand the values that America has stood for, freedom and equality for all nationalities and races and creeds. And they want that. They want what we have here today. And it infuriates me to see people disregarding what they have here in America. They think it's so awful. They want to change it into a communistic, socialistic country where by the millions people are leaving socialistic and communistic countries to come here to America, and we're trying to make America into the horrible nations across the world that everyone's leaving by the thousands. It makes me pretty mad, and I'd be lying if I said it didn't anger me that what some people are trying to do to our nation today. So what can we do? I mean, what can we do? Start the Cornerstone Baptist Militia and overthrow the government? No. We pray, and we claim 1 Chronicles 7:14. We humble ourselves, we seek God's face, and we pray and turn from our evil ways and pray that God would turn this nation back to being a nation under God. We pray, and also we vote. We use the other God-given right that God gave us, and our soldiers and military gave us the liberty to vote. We have a country where we can vote in and vote out the fools that don't represent us, the constituents. We don't like what they're doing, we vote them out. We vote them out. And I tell you what, every Christian that's upset at what America is becoming should vote according to the Bible, should certainly not vote for anybody that's for abortion and for the gay pride agenda and for the woke stuff that's going on today. And a Christian should never vote for someone, it baffles my mind, should never vote for someone that hates America. Tell you what, we vote and we pray and we do everything that we can to win souls for Jesus Christ, because truthfully, that is the only answer. The only answer for our nation today is not in White House, is not in the House, is not in controlling the Senate. It's not a piece of legislature. It is the Lord Jesus Christ in introducing people to saving relationship with him. Miracles, I want to preach on this thought. Miracles that made America. Miracles that made America. God's hand has been on this nation. And if you can't see that in history as you study it, you must be reading your history books with blindfolds on, because you can't help but study and look at our nation's history and the forefathers and the figures that have played an instrumental part in the forming of America and not see the providential hand of God on our nation as we've honored him. And we're going to preach on the miracles that made America, and then we'll make some application as we go. But America is still a great nation because we have the God-given right to worship freely. Aren't you glad for that? Amen. We have the God-given right to freely express and share our faith with others. Some of you haven't gotten past what I said earlier about the politicians. You'll get over it. You'll forgive me. You know I'm right. We have the God-given right to possess and read God's word freely. Aren't you glad for that? We have the God-given right to bear arms. I know there's more of you that have guns in here. I said bear arms, okay? Good. I'm not talking about right arm and left arm. I'm talking about bear arms, okay? To vote in and out politicians who don't represent us. We have the God-given right to own homes and to work our land and provide for our families. We have the God-given right for all people to be equal, regardless of ethnicity, because we're all created by the same Creator God. Amen. We should be thankful for those things as Americans today. And America is a great nation that God has used throughout its history. We can see that in some of the miracles that we have in our history. Here's some miracles for us. We'll go through these quickly. The first miracle that I believe we could see in the history of America is in the divine fog, the miracle of the divine fog. During the Revolutionary War, August 1776, in New York, the British amassed the largest invasion force in world history up until that point. There were 32,000 soldiers, over 400 ships. This was the biggest battle of the whole war to this point. It was the Battle of Brooklyn Heights. Have you heard about that battle? The Battle of Brooklyn Heights. During this battle, 3,000 soldiers would die from the American side to only 392 British soldiers. It was a staggering defeat for America. We were on the cusp of losing our entire army, the entire force, and more importantly, we were in jeopardy of losing George Washington. They were surrounded. Washington made the decision to retreat across the river by ferry to Manhattan Island. And they needed a miracle to get out of it because they were surrounded. The British soldiers were closing in, and a miracle is exactly what happened. A portion of the sea where the British were, a dense fog began to arise over their camp, and then a dense fog began to arise over the camp of the American camp. And in between, people would testify everything was fine, but only over the two camps the dense fog began to settle. At daybreak, only half of the colonial army had evacuated, and half of them were stranded and were quickly to be captured, and George Washington was one of them. And then all of a sudden, miraculously, thick fog rolls in and moved in to provide cover and allow the entire colonial force to retreat under its cover. And everyone, including George Washington, got away. People said that the fog was so thick, you couldn't see 6 yards ahead of you. It was so thick. Some would say that's just a coincidence. But I rather claim that it was God's providential hand working a miracle so that a man that was instrumental in founding our nation could escape and reorganize. You're still not convinced. Here's another one. Here's a miracle of the tornado. Miracle of the tornado. It was August 24th, 1814. British troops, over 4,500 of them, were marching on Washington, D.C. And a British admiral by the name of George Cockburn and his men began burning down the city. They burned down the Library of Congress. They burned down the Department of War and the Treasury. And suddenly, a tornado began to ravage the city. The tornado tore down buildings and actually crashed down the buildings on top of the British's heads. And also a rainstorm accompanied the tornado and extinguished the fires that were just started by the British troops. Coincidence, right? Rather a miracle that God worked to provide the men of the city to escape and further damage to be stopped. God had heard the prayer of the thousands of fasting and praying Americans that had prayed and fast for deliverance. God had heard their prayers and brought them a divine tornado and rainstorm. There were more people killed by the buildings that fell on top of their heads than the colonials resisting the British as they came into the city. Was it a coincidence or a miracle? I believe it was a miracle. Still not convinced. I'll give you one more. Here's the miracle of the restrained rain. December 1944, Hitler had ordered three armies to attack in the Ardennes Forest. The Nazis would surprise and surround the 101st Airborne. Any 101st Airborne here today? 101st Airborne Division in southern Belgium. They demanded that the Allies surrender. And I love this. American General Anthony McAuliffe responded with just one word. You know what word that was? Nuts. Nuts. This actually confused the Nazis' commanders, and they hesitated in advancing. And in their hesitation, General Patton's Third Army had time to come to their rescue. But there was a problem. The Third Army was hunkered down, and because of a fierce rainstorm, mud had been rampant and thick, and they couldn't advance their armored division. They were stranded. 250,000 soldiers were stuck because of rain. So what happened? General Patton ordered his chaplains to organize his 250,000 troops to pray that the rain would stop. Shortly after 250,000 troops prayed, the rain stopped, and the Third Army successfully rescued the 101st Airborne and led them in a counterattack against the Nazis. It was a miracle, wasn't it? It was a miracle. There's so many different miracles I could name to you that God's hand has been on our nation throughout its history. George Washington was riding back and forth in the heat of the battle, and the Indians actually told their Indian forces to concentrate on George Washington. And at the end of the battle, George Washington had 4 bullet holes in his jacket. Think that was a coincidence? No, I think it was a miracle. And so many other ones that we could name. We're going to look at miracles for a moment and draw some application from it. What is a miracle? You think about that word miracle. What is a miracle? And listen, before you make fun of me, it's a miracle that I married the wife that I did, okay? I'm not talking about that kind of miracle. We all understand I married up. Okay, let's move on. A miracle is only something God can do. A miracle is only something God can do. And some of the miracles that we just named only can be given credit to God. I mean, God is the one that has control over the weather and the rain and stopping the rain and bringing fog. It's a miracle that God brought. And we see through the miracles that God worked throughout our nation's history, battles that were won. I mean, wars were won when they shouldn't have been won. I mean, we went against, as colonials, we were farmers that had hunting rifles. We were going up against the greatest force in the world, the British Empire. Professional soldiers. There's no reason why farmers should be professional soldiers apart from God had a divine purpose and plan for the establishment of America. Amen. And God worked a miracle. Wars were won. Enemies defeated. Lives that were saved. Economies recovered. Freedoms preserved. So what are some things that even miracles can't do? What are some things that even miracles can't do? Number one, miracles alone won't save your soul from hell. Miracles alone won't save your soul from hell. I mean, think about the gospel this morning. When you think about the gospel, it's a miraculous thing. Everything about the gospel is miraculous. There was a miraculous conception when the Holy Ghost overshadowed a Virgin Mary. It was a miraculous birth when Jesus, as Scripture predicted, was born, just as Scripture predicted. It was a miraculous deliverance when King Herod sought to kill the Messiah by killing all the young children. He was miraculously delivered from Herod. There was a miraculous Father. God manifested Himself in the person of Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Miraculous life that was lived. When Jesus lived as 100% God, indwelt in 100% flesh as man, and He lived a perfect life, and He was tempted in all points as we are tempted, and yet without sin. It was a miraculous life that He lived, sinlessly perfect. And then He died on the cross willingly for our sins. He willingly went to the grave and stayed there 3 days and rose up victorious from the death and the devil in the grave. Gave us victory over death, the devil, and the grave. Everything about the gospel is miraculous. But even the miracle of the gospel, miracles alone won't save our souls from hell. Even with all the miracles of Christ's birth and life and death and resurrection, it all comes down to your heart, your faith, and a personal decision that you have to make. Amen. Accepting the miraculous gift that He's offering you, eternal life. Even a miraculous death and miraculous life and resurrection of Jesus Christ won't save you. You've got to willingly choose to receive Him as your personal Savior. In Acts chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says this, "And His name, through faith in His name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by Him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Acts chapter 3 is an example of the miraculous power that Jesus Christ possessed. And just having the power, Jesus having the power and having the ability to work a miracle didn't save this man. It required the man's faith in Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 10, verse 17, the Bible says, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." In spite of all the miracles that Jesus performed, the thing that hindered Jesus and what he desired to do for people was what? Unbelief. In Matthew chapter 17, verse number 20, the Bible says, "And Jesus said unto them, because of your," what's the next word? "Unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you." Well, Pastor Morton, do you still believe that miracles could happen today? That God has power to do the same thing in our nation as he did before? Absolutely yes. Because God hasn't changed. God hasn't moved. God hasn't deterred from his purpose. It's us. It's our nation that's done that. It's our nation that's forsaken God. It's our nation that's turned our back on the word of God. It's us that's changed. We're the ones that need to repent. We're the ones that need to get right. We're the ones that need to turn back to God. It's us. It's our nation. God wants to do miracles. God wants to bless our nation. God wants to work in us and through us. But how can he when we're killing babies by the millions? How can we when we're just desecrating God's word? How can we when we deny the faith that our nation was founded upon? How can he when we turn a blind eye and we bite our tongue and we do nothing about the homosexual and sodomy and transgender and lesbianism and all that stuff that's going on today? How can he? We got to repent and turn back to God and get our hearts right before we do that. But I believe with all my heart that God can still work miracles today because God hasn't diminished in his power and ability. But the thing that hindered God from doing miracles then is unbelief. People's unbelief. In John chapter 14, verse number 12, the Bible says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he also do. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." Do you know what he was telling his disciples? "Listen, you're marveling at me bringing back to life a fig tree. If you will believe me, you can do greater things than I've ever done here on the earth. You can do greater things. I have a desire for you to do more for me than what you've seen me do." But it was dependent upon the disciples' faith and belief in the Lord Jesus. It's still the same thing today. The thing that prevents and hinders miracles from being seen and experienced is still unbelief. The only thing that will keep you this morning from being miraculously born again and saved is unbelief. It's the only thing that God can't force you to do, and that's believe and trust him. He's done everything. He's died for you. He shed his blood for you. He made it possible for you to be reconciled back to God. He's done everything. And all you need to do is believe and trust him. Miracles alone won't make you believe. The second thing that miracles can't do, miracles alone won't make you believe. "Well, that's not true. Pastor Morton, if I could just personally see and experience a miracle in my life, I would trust Christ." No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't, because you're no different than Thomas, his disciple that was there with Jesus Christ his whole entire earthly ministry. You're no different than Thomas. I'm no different than Thomas. He saw everything that Jesus did, and he still wasn't satisfied until he said, "You know what? I won't believe what Christ predicted he would do and rise from the dead until I put my fingers in the holes in his hand and I see the hole in his side. I won't believe it." After all the miracles, he personally witnessed Jesus Christ doing his ministry. If you saw a miracle, that wouldn't make you believe. You're not telling the truth. The Pharisees saw the miracles, that Jesus performed, because they watched him. They watched he and his disciples with a magnifying glass. They saw the miracles that he did. They didn't believe. God's people, the ones he came to redeem and save, they saw the miracles that he did, and they rejected him as their Messiah. What makes you and I think we're any different? If we just saw a miracle, that's all we need to do to believe. Nope, miracles alone won't make you believe. So what does belief do in our lives? What does belief do in our lives? Well, number one, it brings salvation. Belief brings salvation. In John chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Believing is what's necessary to have a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Mark chapter 16 and verse 16, the Bible says this in Mark 16, 16, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." Believing brings salvation. It brings salvation. Number two, belief brings deliverance. Belief brings deliverance. And let's turn to Mark chapter 9 quickly. Mark chapter 9, and look at it in verses 23 through 25. Mark chapter 9, verses 23 through 25. The Bible says this, "Jesus said unto him, If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him." You need to believe that the power of God is possible in your life. Believe that the power of God's deliverance is possible in your life. A part of the battle of someone coming to Jesus Christ for salvation is for them to believe that he's God enough to deliver them from the sin that they're involved in. They've got to believe that deliverance is possible with God. There's people that say that, I'm addicted to drugs, and I'm addicted to pornography, and maybe you're addicted to pride, or maybe you're involved in a homosexual lifestyle, or alcoholism, fornication, immorality, or whatever else that has you bound. You may look at yourself and think, there's no way that God could save me because of the sins that are in my life, the things that are holding me captive. There's no way that I could have deliverance. I'm telling you, the first part of getting saved is just realizing God's power is enough to deliver you from whatever that has you bound. I mean, there's people today that are maybe sitting in this room that were alcoholics, and God miraculously, when they put their faith and trust in him, changed their life forever. He can do it for you too. He can do it for you too. There's people that were addicted to sexual activity, and there was people addicted to all kinds of things, drugs and smoking and everything else you could name, and God miraculously delivered them because they believed that he could deliver them. If you're here, the first part is just it's just realizing God's power is enough to deliver you from whatever has you bound. I believe this. Believe that God can deliver you from the sins that haunt your mind and conscience, the sins that make you feel disgust and regret, and the weight from the burden of carrying those sins around. God can deliver you from that too. I'm telling you what, sometimes a physical deliverance, it takes place quicker than the emotional and the mental deliverance that's necessary. But God is powerful enough to remove any memory that haunts your mind. God's power is powerful enough to deliver even your conscience that beats you up for things from your past. I'm telling you what, you have, in the truest sense of the word, deliverance available to you. Complete deliverance is what God's offering you today. And you could have it if you have enough faith to believe God is God enough to deliver you from those things. And number three, I believe this. Belief not only brings salvation. Number two, belief not only brings deliverance, But belief brings answers to prayer. Belief brings answers to prayer. I look at our prayer list with 55 names on it. 55 names of people that have real problems, that have real needs in their life. Pancreatic cancer that's paralyzing and crippling their bodies. So many loved ones in here with dementia. So many people here that are struggling physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We have a lot of people that need prayers answered. I believe this. We need to believe that belief brings answers to prayer. Do you believe that God hears prayer, hears our prayers?
Amen.
Do you believe that? Do you believe that God not only hears your prayers, but has a desire and has the ability to answer those prayers?
Amen.
Do you believe that? In James chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, I'm reminded about this. In James chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, it says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and abradeth not, and it shall be given. Verse number 6, but let him ask in, what's the next word?
Faith.
Nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Some would ask, what is prayer, Pastor Morton? Simply what we find in James chapter 1, asking of God. Prayer is asking of God. It's more than that, we know. It's communication to God. It's us speaking to Him and waiting for Him to speak in return. It's bringing our petitions to Him. But it's in the basic crux of what prayer is. It's us as finite beings standing in need of deliverance and help. And we go to the one who's infinite to get those prayers answered and get the help that we need. Prayer is asking, but I want to submit to you, prayer is asking, it's more than just asking. In verse number 6 it says, but let him ask in faith. Prayer is asking in faith. Simply put, it's praying, believing that God can answer your prayers. We need to believe that prayer, when we believe, belief brings answers to prayer. I understand, God always answers in accordance to His will. I understand that. I understand also that He answers in accordance to His own purpose and plan. And I understand that He answers in a way that will always glorify Him. I understand that. But I can't help but think about all the prayers in my own life that could have been answered had I simply believed that God could and would answer them. How many prayers of mine did I forfeit when I prayed and didn't truly believe the prayer that I was praying and the God that was God enough to answer the prayer? It's very easy to do. Hit your knees and utter words. But how many times do we actually pray from a heart of faith that God was God enough to answer the prayer? And how many of us have enough faith to ask whatever His will be done? I think a lot of time we forfeit prayers not only because we don't have the heart of faith that prayers that ask in belief, but also I believe we forfeit prayers by asking our will be done instead of the Father's will. We should always pray, whatever Your will is, that be done. And that takes faith. That takes faith. I lost several people close to me in my life. My grandpa, my grandma, several sets of uncles and aunts and things like that that were close to me. And I prayed like everybody else would. Lord, please just heal them. Lord, please heal them. What if that wasn't God's purpose and plan? What if God's will was to bring them home and work some good for us in His glory? We should pray always for His will to be done. How many unanswered prayers do I have because I didn't believe like I should have? Something to think about. Something to think about for sure. Miracles are great. Some of you have maybe even experienced miracles that can't be explained except God worked a miracle in your life. Praise the Lord for that. Some would say, you know what, Pastor Morton, if I just saw a miracle and experienced a miracle for myself, then I would believe more. No, you wouldn't. Because God doesn't desire for our lives to be operated from miracle to miracle. Do you know what should suffice in every believer's life this morning? Right there. God's given us a miraculous book. God's given us a book that has instructions, step-by-step instructions. And God's given us a book from Genesis to Revelation that there's profit there for every aspect of our life and practice. God's revealed miraculously everything we need to believe and to claim right here. You mean to tell me that God's given you His Word right there in English, right there? We have a freedom to read it. We have a freedom to read it. We have a church that teaches it, and we teach it verse by verse, and we teach it in context, and we teach it pure like it comes from the Word of God. And you tell me you read it, and you won't just believe that, and you'll just believe some miracle that comes by? No, you won't, because you don't even believe this like you should. I don't believe this like I should. We need to focus on taking this for what it is and believe this and have this govern our life and guide our life. Not waking up looking to the sky for some message in the sky. God's not going to write a message in the sky. He's written it on paper in a book. God's not going to open the sky and just fall out miracles to guide us in life. God's given us a book for that. God's given us a book for that. And we need to take His book for what it is, a miraculous book that's the sole authority for everything in our life and faith and how He put that into practice. That's how He's going to govern our lives. And in conclusion, let me have every head bowed, every eye closed. In conclusion, this morning, America, I believe, is a great nation that has been greatly blessed by God as we have honored God and His Word. As we have gotten away from that is when we've experienced the turmoil and the trouble and the problems that we have today. What's the answer? Get back to honoring God and His Word. That's the answer. Just get back to honoring God and His Word. Our nation has had the miraculous hand of God working in our nation throughout its history to create, establish, and preserve our nation today. We need to recognize it, appreciate it, and thank God for the miracles that He's done for us. As incredible as the stories of miracles in our history is, there is no amount of miracles that could make you and I trust Christ our Savior. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you don't know for sure that if you died where you sat today, that you would be in the presence of God in heaven. Wouldn't you like to get that settled today? Wouldn't you like to know for sure that heaven would be your home? Well, Pastor Morton, do you really believe the stories that were shared in our history of the miracles that God did? I absolutely do. Do you really believe the miracles can happen today? Yes, I can. I do believe. Do you know how? How do you know for sure that miracles can happen today? I am a miracle. I am a miracle. It's a miracle that I'm saved. I'm telling you what, without God and the grace of God in my life, I'd be lost. I'd be on my way to hell. I'd be a wretched sinner the rest of my life. But God, in His miraculous love, in His miraculous death, His miraculous resurrection, and when I place my faith and trust in the miraculous gospel, I got miraculously saved. So I am a miracle. Remember, miracles only are something that God can do. It's a miracle that I'm saved and you're saved here this morning. Because God knows I can't save myself. Forget about hearing people say I'm good enough or I can work my way there. I can have my good outweigh my bad. I can give enough money. I can go to enough church services. I can get dunked in a tank enough. No, friend, the only way you're getting to God in heaven is through accepting Jesus Christ as His Son today. I'm begging you and pleading with you that you'll do that. And I wonder this morning if anybody here, while every head is bowed, every eye closed, I wonder, is there anybody here say, Pastor Morton, I don't know for sure that I'm saved. I don't know for sure that I'm saved. If I were to die right now, I don't know that heaven would be my home. Would you raise your hand? Anybody else like that? God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else like that? What I want you to do is this. I want you to do is Ivan, would you come talk to that young man? Anybody else say, Pastor Morton, man, I got so many questions. I've got some doubts about it. I'm not sure that I'm saved, but I want to know. I want to know that for sure and get that settled once and for all today. Say, Pastor Morton, would you pray for me? I'd love to pray for you. Would you raise your hand and let me pray for you? Anybody here say, Pastor Morton, I'd like to be saved and know more about how I can do that. Anybody at all? Okay, well, God bless you. We're going to have everybody stand to your feet. And as Brother Tar leads us in a song, the altar's open. Maybe you're here and you need to be saved. Would you come forward and allow us to show you from the Bible how to be saved? Maybe you're already saved, but God's spoken in your heart about doing more for Him. We can talk to you about that. Maybe you need to be baptized. You've never been baptized. Maybe you're looking for a church to join, and you got some questions about how to do that. Whatever God's speaking in your heart about, would you come forward and let us speak to you about that? We'd love to do that. As we sing,
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Before we sing the last verse, maybe you're here and you just need to thank the Lord for saving your soul. Maybe you need to thank the Lord for being born and raised in America where you're free. Maybe you have somebody that you know, a friend or family, a relative, co-worker that needs to be saved. Whatever God's laying on your heart to do, this will be the last verse that you have to do that. And we can help you with anything you need help with as we sing.
I need thee every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Amen. Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. Well, thank you so much for visiting with us this morning. And we're praying that God keeps you safe if you travel out of state or out of city for Memorial Day. And if you're shooting off fireworks, I pray that God keeps you safe from losing digits and eyes and everything else. And I pray that you be back with us tonight at 6 p.m. And the Lord bless you and keep you safe as we go our separate ways. If you're visiting with us, we're so happy to have you. And we have Eric. If Eric, would you raise your hand? Eric? Is Eric here? God bless you, Eric. We're so happy to have you, brother. And let's go make sure that we go by, introduce ourselves, and make him feel welcome. And we also have Ryan and Cassandra. We have Cassandra's parents with us. Remind me your names again. I'm sorry, what is it? Andrew and Patsy. They're from Kentucky. Anybody from Kentucky here? All right, any Wildcat fans? Whew. Two. All right, we got two. Okay, make sure you go by and tell them they're in Hoosier country, okay? Indiana Hoosiers or Boilermakers. But go by and make them feel welcome, and let's be dismissed in prayer. And Brother Haig, would you pray for us, please?
What you do. Thank you for the day you've given us. Pray you just help us to never forget those that have passed on before us in wartime and different fields across the seas. Lord, we just praise you for those folks that have surrendered their all and given their life for our freedom that we have today. Pray that we would draw closer to you in our relationship as we have those freedoms right now, that we would take advantage of those freedoms and don't forget the freedoms that we have. Pray that you would help us to, Lord, just draw closer to you and exercise those freedoms that are obtained from the blood of many fellow servants before us. And Lord, just praise you for that, and we just thank you for the freedom that you have given this country and the miracles that you performed before. Lord, keep us safe on the way as we leave. Help us to return again this evening at 6 o'clock. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.